on YouTube now. And I have another minute to go before we start. So Prateep Mazumdar is saying good morning, Swamiji, to you.
Yes.
Good morning. He's a professor at Shulini, and Colonel Gill is also a part of the Shulini family.
I see.
So it's 11:30, and we'll go live in 30 seconds, Vivek. So
sure.
If you allow me. So it's time to start. Good morning, everyone. Jai Guru. It's an absolute delight for me to be here today because it's a very, very special day for us. We started the Yogananda Guru series with the desire that every soul around us gets enlightened by knowledge, enlightened by peace, and enlightened by happiness. We are honored and delighted that today we have Swami Smarnananji Giri with us today. Swamiji has been a very ardent follower of Paramahansa Yogananji for a very long time. He's also the Vice President of the Yogananda Satsang Society. But the way I admire Swamiji is his journey from being an IITian to becoming a monk, and we'd love to hear a bit about that later on. But welcome to the talk, Swamiji. We're all very, very excited to hear you. We also have hosting Swamiji Vivek Atre. Vivek, as you all know, is a visiting faculty with Shulini and also an advisor, but also again, a very, very keen follower of the YSS. So I won't take more time. I'm going to hand it over to Vivek to host the talk with Swami Smarnanandaji. Over to you, Vivek.
Thank you, Professor Atul Khosla, Pro Vice Chancellor of Shulini University. A very warm welcome to Swami Smarnananji. It's such a delight and pleasure and blessing to have you here on this Yogananda Guru series, lecture series. Swamiji, it is wonderful that you have been able to join us for this session, and we'll be listening to you. And Atul Khosla, I must tell you, he's very humble, but he's also from IIT Kanpur, and worked for McKinsey and various global organizations before coming back to Shulini. And since you are also from IIT Kharagpur, I am feeling a little low because I am from NIT only. So NIT Kurukshetra, but that is only in a lighter vein. It is wonderful to have this session and on meditation and how we can lead happier and more balanced lives. For viewers, I must tell you that Swamiji has not only been a monk for so many years, but also has been very inspiring to all devotees with his satsangs and lectures and talks, not only in the sanghams which devotees attend in the ashrams, but also in his talks all over India, where he has spoken to large audiences throughout India over the last many years. And especially during the 100 years of YSS and 125 years of Paramahansa Yogananji's birth, also we had special lectures. And Swamiji has also spoken at Shimla and Chandigarh, which are very close to Solan in that sense, where Shulini University is located. So this is a wonderful opportunity for all of us to renew our devotees, to renew our determination to meditate regularly, and also to listen to Swamiji's views on how meditation actually helps each human being. And not only helps, but even those who are only curious about meditation as of now, or have just joined, who are not devotees, I would like to urge you to listen carefully to the lecture. And by telling you that Swamiji is an engineer and a scientist, and would have been in India's missile program had he not decided to be a part of YSS. By telling you that Atul and I are also engineers, so I think the engineers and the scientists in the audience can feel comfortable that meditation is something for all of us, and all of us should practice it. So over to Swami Smarnananji for his talk. And Swamiji, warm welcome to you. And we look forward to your satsang now.
Love and greetings to all of you. It's a joy to be visiting Shulini University, although on a screen. And think of the fond memories I have of my previous visits. The previous visits were physical visits. I was always impressed by the infrastructure, ambience, and environs of Shulini University. So nicely located in a beautiful setup, rolling hills all around. Not only the physical location infrastructure, I am also impressed with the purpose, aims, and ideals of this university. Quality education, not only mere academics, but also research, high quality research that's happening there. We must congratulate Professor P.K. Khosla and his team. Now, coming to today's topic, the importance of meditation in leading a joyous and balanced life. Paramhansa Yogananji, the author of this famous book, Autobiography of a Yogi, whose teachings I follow, he said something to the effect, everyone would meditate if only one knows how to meditate. Everyone would meditate if only one knows how to meditate. I mean, that is the efficacy of meditation. It helps so much. It is a tool to bring out the joy which is already existing within each one of us. There is joy. Taittiriya Upanishad says, from joy we have come, for joy we live, and in that sacred joy, one day we shall melt again. In a world of duality, where we see so much pain and suffering all around us, such a statement may sound unrealistic. Isn't it so? Is it possible that I have come from joy and I can live in perpetual joy? We may not fully appreciate the deeper meaning of the statement, but one thing is for sure, the words of an Upanishad cannot go wrong. If only we practice the principles well mapped out by ancient rishis, one day we will watch for the veracity of such statements. It must be true. I have come from joy, and it's possible for me to live in perpetual joy no matter what's happening. As a result, no matter what's happening around me, what is happening to me, I can be joyful. Bhagavan Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Svalpam apyasya dharmasya trayate mahato bhayat. Referring to yoga meditation, Krishna says, Even a little practice of this yoga meditation will save you from dire fears. Trayate mahato bhayat, dire fears. It seems as long as we have life, what is guaranteed is anxiety. Everyone is anxious, whether it's a boy of 10-year-old or a 20-year-old college student or a 30-year-old housewife, a 40-year-old businessman, or an engineer, or a retired person, what next? Always, what next? That anxiety seems to be so much built in today's life. What's happening? What's going to happen? This can be conquered. Gita doesn't say that by practicing yoga meditation, you'll be saved from all troubles and problems in life. No, but we can conquer the fears and anxieties that come out of these troubles. That is what is more important. We have no control over the events that come into our life, but we can live fearlessly. As a result, we can be calmly active and actively calm. Like a prince of peace, sitting on a throne of poise, and directing my kingdom of activities. I can be calmly active and actively calm. How to achieve this? Meditation. Why? How meditation works? I'll give an example. If you have fever, you approach a doctor. Doctor gives you a standard tablet, paracetamol. If you take paracetamol, it reduces the temperature. Is it all what doctor gives you? No. In addition to paracetamol, doctor gives another tablet. That is antibiotic. Because paracetamol only reduces temperature, giving you symptomatic relief. But as long as the bacteria inside that's not removed, you have no real cure. The bacteria which is causing this temperature, that has to be removed for a permanent cure. So that's what we want, not just temperature going down. That bacteria has to be removed. Antibiotic is also required. Same thing in life. I have this financial problem. I have this professional problem. I have this health issue. I have this family troubles. I have these relationship problems. These are all real problems to me. If I try to solve this family problem, it may come back again. Or this may be resolved, but financial problem is there, or some other problem is there. So we are trying to remove one problem, means we are seeking temporary symptomatic relief. We have to remove the root cause which is giving rise to this problem. What is that root cause which is giving rise to the external problems like financial problem, family problem, professional problem, like environmental problem, all these things? That is ajnana, ignorance. Ignorance of the divinity within. Potentially, we are all divine. That we are forgetting and living like mortals. That's the reason we are caught up with these problems of a mortal being. Never trying to touch that divinity already within each one of us. And the way to touch the divinity is through meditation. Meditation takes you inside. Once you touch the divinity, you have a solution for everything. Through intuition, you solve that problems. And nature, true nature inside is joy, love. let me explain in another way. So I have this body. I have a responsibility to take care of this body by right diet, right exercise. When I take care of my body, in turn, body gives me health, mobility. I also have a mind. I have to cultivate my mind by positive thinking, intellectual pursuits. When I take care of my mind, in turn, mind gives me intelligence, ability to get along with others. Many people stop here. They take care of their minds and their bodies. But man is of threefold nature. I have a body, I have a mind, I also have a soul. I have a responsibility to nourish my soul too. The nourishment for my soul is deep contemplation, meditation. When I nourish my soul with proper food, that is meditation, in turn, soul gives me intuition, creativity, perfect love, unconditional joy. Creativity doesn't come from mind or body. It comes through from soul. So I have a responsibility to take care of my body, mind and soul. In turn, I get not only health, not only intelligence, but also intuition and unconditional joy and love. Then only the balance is there in life. Without these things, I am not complete. I am not full. Something is missing in my life. As long as I don't take care of my soul also, in addition to body and mind. The here, meditation counts. Meditation helps to nourish the soul. Each one of us. That it's hung, it's looking for that. It's hungry. Soul is waiting for its food. I would like to digress a little bit and address one point here. What is God? God is a word we have been hearing from childhood, a concept we are asked to believe. Did we ever stop and contemplate what it is? There are many, many definitions of God, many, many descriptions are there. Books have been written, lectures spoken. All are right in their own right. But to me, the definition of God closest to my heart is this. God is Sachidananda. That's definition I like most. God is Sachidananda. What does it mean, Sachidananda? Again, Sachidananda is a word we have been hearing. We name our children also Sachidananda. But what does it mean? Sachidananda. Let me explain that. We need to understand this basic concept. God, at this point, we have no idea. What is God? I have no clue. Whether God is he or she or it, whatever it is, if there is some entity like God, can that God be sorrowful? No. God cannot be sorrowful. God is joy. We are not making any mistake by assuming that God is joy. But to say that God is joy is a grass understatement. God is not simple joy, which we are normally aware. For instance, if you take a mango, it gives me joy. If I take a second mango, that gives me further joy. But third mango doesn't give me the same joy. Fourth, I don't want to take. Because the theory of diminishing returns, the theory of marginal utility, applies here. This is applicable to all, not only to mangoes, but all items, all experience in this life. Imagine there is some experience which we liked once, twice, thrice, slowly, 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 we lose interest. But there is one thing in this creation which never goes stale. That is God and God contact. The contact with God in meditation is ever new joy. Ever new joy. God is not simple joy, it is ever new joy. It is, somebody else may be thinking, I saw him meditating today, yesterday, then day for yesterday. How does it matter if it doesn't make meditate tomorrow? No. It's not the same joy, it's ever new, like sleep. I slept last 6 days. Doesn't mean that I don't have to sleep today. I sleep, joy is ever new again, fresh. The joy of sleep never goes stale. Much more than that, fresh, ever new is God contact in meditation. God himself is ever new joy. God may be ever new joy, but what good it is if he is not aware of his joy. God is always conscious, aware, ever conscious of his ever new joy. What is consciousness? Chit. God is Chidanand, ever conscious, ever new bliss. He may be ever conscious of his ever new joy, but what good it is if it exists for a little while and then gone? No. God has always been there. See, as a human being, I can relate to events between my birth and death. But God is, God was, and God will be. God is ever existing. God is ever existing, ever conscious, ever new joy. Ever existing is truth, Sat. God is Sat Chit Anand, Sat Chit Anand, ever existing, ever conscious, ever new joy. But I don't stop here when I talk about God. My full definition of God is Sat Chit Anand and Aham Brahmasmi. Aham Brahmasmi is not my statement. All scriptures say that. All saints proclaim that. Aham means I. Brahmasmi means Brahman. I am potentially Brahman. I am potentially ever existing, ever conscious, ever new joy. I mean, that is my true nature. Now, can you correlate this with Taittiriya Upanishad, which says, from joy have come, for joy I live, in that sacred joy one day I shall melt again. Because it's the same thing, that potentially I'm divine joy. And the way to contact that, to bring it out, is through meditation. That is why, no matter what's happening around me, no matter what's happening to me, I can still be joyful if only I contact him through meditation. Before I move forward, I would like to explain this joy. Because joy is not something unknown to us. We are joyful when we eat some nice food. We are joyful when we meet a good person. But this joy of God contact in meditation is so different. God's joy is so different. To explain the joy, to describe, it's so difficult. But at least I can make an attempt by saying that this joy has three shades. It is physiological, it is psychological, it is spiritual. It has three shades. Physiological in the sense that when I take a mango, my taste buds get excited and hence I am happy. If when I take a mango or a sweet, no one needs to tell me that you are taking a sweet, be happy. No one needs to tell me. It's automatically I am joyful. Because it happens physiologically, there are changes here, I am joyful, which produces joy. Similarly, with meditation, when you meditate, physiologically some changes, brain cells and the body feels so light. You are joyful, automatically joyful. That physiologically there is joy coming through meditation. It's also psychological in the sense, for me to be happy, I don't have to necessarily take a mango. I'm just sitting here. If I hear some good news, something happened to my family, to my country, or to my company, or whatever, something psychologically, I feel joyful. Same thing. When you meditate, even though nothing you see in front of you, nothing happened, nothing, but psychologically, you know that, yes, all will be well. Some joy is there, psychologically. And more importantly, spiritual. For this, I would like to quote words of Paramahansa Yogananda. He said, when bliss comes over you, you recognize it as a conscious, intelligent, universal being to whom you may appeal, and not an abstract mental concept. Mark his words. What Paramahansa said, when joy comes over you in meditation, you recognize that joy as a conscious, intelligent, universal being to whom you may appeal. Meaning in meditation, that joy comes with a sense of higher presence. With a sense of higher presence. It doesn't mean that we are going to see a person there with four heads and eight hands sitting on a throne. No. If someone sees like that, it's okay. I have no issue with that. But generally, it comes with a sense of deep, deep conviction. Yes. Without seeing anyone, without hearing anything, you know that this has come from some higher presence, that joy, where you can make a connection. I mean, that is a beauty. That is a beauty. Because it's your own inside. It is your own. The joy comes. That is what we're all looking for. Every human being is looking for that happiness. No matter what's happening around me, no matter what's happening to me, I would like to be happy. That is possible in meditation because it's a pickaxe to unearth the joy which is already within you. That is it. Next. And now we have the examples of many, many, many people, saints, who had a lot of difficulties in life, but they're joyful because they contact the joy within and they're performing their duty outside. I would like to give some mundane examples. Why talk about saints of 300 years, 400 years ago? One is where I am a witness. IIT Kharagpur, this happened in Kharagpur, way back in 1980, 81, 39 years back. One of my core research scholars finished his PhD and he was attending the Viva Voce exam. That means defending his thesis. We all assembled in a seminar hall. About 50 to 60 people were there, just seminar hall were assembled. They're waiting for the external examiner to come and conduct that Viva Voce. The external examiner was Professor B. Nag, Secretary, Department of Electronics, Central Government, Delhi. He was the one who built the first computer in India in 1970s. As soon as Professor B. Nag entered, he asked my head of the department, Professor Sarap, where is the candidate? He wanted to greet him before starting the exam. So Professor Sarap introduced, here is the candidate. So as soon as Professor Nag saw the candidate, he went back like this. You appear so relaxed as if exam is already over. You appear so relaxed as if the exam is already over. These are the comments coming from external examiner of the stature of Professor B. Nag. Because exam means what? Thup, 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 thup. Heart must be beating. Whether it's exam of 10th class or a college or a PhD or even professional life, presentations, seminars, wherever, it's always the anxiety, you know, what's going to be there, how I'm going to perform. But here is a candidate who was so relaxed. Later he remarked, what is there to be tensed about? I am relaxed. Because I have prepared thoroughly. I am here to defend. This person, candidate, was practicing Kriya Yoga taught by Paramahansa Yogananda for about 1 year. See, if this is what you could give, don't you want to be like that? Free from fear, free from tension, as if exam is already over, but ready for the exam. We all want that meditation can do that. It can do that. That's why Paramahansa said, everyone would meditate if only one knows how to meditate scientifically. One more. There was an young IAS officer. He was in Patna. He would regularly meditate morning and evening. His colleagues knew that he would meditate. They asked him, "We don't understand. How do you meditate? How do you work by spending so much time in meditation? Because IAS officers are on duty 24 hours. No, how do you find time? How do you work by spending so much time in meditation?" The young IAS officer replied, "Yes, I don't understand. How do you work without spending so much time in meditation? Because meditation is the one which is giving me the strength, courage, the fearlessness to face my daily challenges. Don't you want that?" Next. This happened in Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, Hyderabad, but I was working there for some time, HAL. Now, we used to have a day and a half weekend, Saturday off, Sunday off, Monday we go to work. When we go to work Monday, then most people would say, again Monday, you know, again 5.5 days of work. But one among us would say, "Now Monday," very enthusiastic. Now what used to happen is, weekend means what? Outings, parties, movies, going here, going there, all this, by spend time in activity, and by Monday morning, one is tired. Again, 5.5 days of drudgery here. Now this one person who was meditating, he would spend a little longer time in meditation, reading, etc., and with family, more time. By Monday, he is refreshed, enthusiastic. I mean, that's what meditation can do. It doesn't dissipate our energies. It boosts our energy. One more example I would like to quote. This is useful for students and researchers, for that matter, everyone who need focus in life. Once one ashram head, Mahant, passed away, when some ceremony was happening, guests were there. Someone asked an ashraman, "What was it to which your master gave maximum importance when he was alive? What was it to which your master gave maximum importance when he was alive?" The disciple answered, "My master gave maximum importance to whatever he was doing at that point." You see that? If I was reading a book, the book is most important thing in this creation, maximum importance. If he's talking to a person, that person is most important thing in this creation, he would focus. If he's taking food, that is most important. One thing at a time, everything, that focus, that also comes with meditation, concentration, concentration. When you're focusing, other things can wait. No worries, no fears, no anxieties. Now you are here at present, fully enjoying, fully focusing, resolving the issues. That is also possible in meditation, which is lacking in restless youth these days. That focus, always mind is going in different directions. So meditation can help us in many ways. Now, before I go forward to talk a little bit about meditation, what is meditation? I can take some questions if there are any. Otherwise, I can proceed with that. I leave it to the host, Atul and Vivek.
Swamiji, let's proceed. We can take questions at the end.
Pardon?
We can take questions at the end. We can proceed.
And then I can resume. If there is time, I can resume also.
Please resume. Please start. We are listening to you, Swamiji.
Yes, any question, Vivek?
Swamiji, you can continue for some time and then after 5 minutes, we'll take questions. Swamiji. You can continue for another 5 minutes if you like. Otherwise, as you say.
No, depending on the questions, I can continue.
Yeah, there are some questions, but you can continue for another 5 minutes, Swamiji.
Okay. Okay, then something about what is meditation? See, one person approached a saint and asked, please let me know what is God in one sentence. I don't have time for your lectures. Tell me what is God in one sentence. Then the saint replied, why one sentence? One word will do. Silence. What God is silence? Yes, silence. What is silence? Meditation. How do you meditate in silence? How do you get that silence? By meditation. Now here, the three words, God, silence, meditation are used as if they refer to same thing, which is true. In the silence which the saint is referring to in a higher sense is not a mere silence of vocal cords. Vocal cords have to be silent. Thoughts have to be silent. Emotions have to be silent. Anxieties have to be silent. Eyes have to be silent. Ears have to be silent. Skin has to be silent. All senses have to be silent. That is the state he is referring to. For me, a better word here is stillness. Nischal. Stillness. Imagine a state where your thoughts are absent, emotions are not there, anxieties are not there, your eyes, ears, skin are not giving any sensations. Imagine a state, where are you? Aham Brahmasmi. You are with God. You are God. Spark of the divinity is in you. You are enjoying that. This can happen in, this happens in sleep. In sleep, I don't see, I don't hear, I don't feel a touch, no sensation. But unfortunately, in sleep, my mind is not in my control and I can't use that freedom from sensations and anything good. But in meditation, something similar, conscious sleep, loosely speaking, something similar. In the sense, you don't have thoughts, anxieties, fear, sensations. At the same time, mind is active. Consciousness is alive. That through that you perceive that divinity which is already within you. I mean, that is meditation. A process which takes you to that state where you are able to feel that freedom from all sensations, anxieties, everything, thoughts. You are there within yourself. Where, what is inside? Satchidanand, ever existing, ever conscious, ever new joy. That the joy you feel, that is meditation. That is meditation. Here, see, just hearing the word meditation, some people start sitting and and trying to do something with their mind. It doesn't help that way. It should be scientific. Yoga Sustaining Society of India established a Paramshiva Anandji. We teach the ancient techniques. These techniques which we teach are not introduced by Paramshiva Anandji nor his guru. They are coming from time immemorial. Some of these techniques are as old as breath, creation. They are coming from there. And if you scientifically this technique, Kriya Yoga, for example, is an ancient science for modern man, even for modern man. It works on life force. Because I am sustained by life force, I work on life force, pranayama. Pranayama means pranayama, life force control, control of life force. I control the life force using some techniques, pranayama techniques. Thereby, I can control the senses. I can subdue the senses like in sleep, but consciously. And that consciousness awakened, that can be used for something good. This is meditation. And we, Yoga Sustaining Society, with headquarters in Ranchi, ashrams in different places, whoever is interested, they can enroll. We teach them through lessons, printed word, no confusion. Printed word, you get lessons to your home and read and practice. We have three techniques of meditation. Ahamsa technique of concentration, next Om technique of meditation, then Kriya technique. With these three techniques, we go inside, interiorize, antarmukhi. We go inside and touch that joy, wisdom, love that is already existing within Satchidananda. Scientifically, we practice the techniques morning and evening. Anyone is interested, most welcome. You write to Ranchi. Now online courses are, online lessons are available. You receive them and practice. Practice, that's important. Without practice, it's all theory. We have to practice. See, as you cannot eat for me, I cannot meditate for you. You have to meditate, you have to control your life force, pranayama, you have to do it, and then you go within and experience that. Then you are bubbling with energy. You are bubbling with energy. And the joy, freedom from fear, fearlessly living, with courage, we can face our day-to-day challenges in this life. Let me go back. An affirmation given by Guruji. I'll be calmly active and actively calm, a prince of peace, sitting in a throne of poise and directing my kingdom of activities. That means I am not inactive. I am actually doing it. After all, meditation I do maybe an hour in the morning, an hour in the evening, something like that. Rest of the time, I am active. I have responsibilities to perform joyously, efficiently. So it's not running away from our day-to-day life. We face life, but with the joy and love, enthusiasm, interest, fearlessness, courage. These things, they're already there inside. We bring them out and face the world. Yes, with this introduction now I can field questions. Later, if there is time, I'll go into meditation once again.
Yes, Swamiji, now we'll take questions. There are about 8 to 10 questions, Swamiji, so I'll ask them one by one. Should I go ahead now?
Yes.
Okay, Swamiji, so the first question is, should we find the guru or will the guru find us?
See, now, if you are interested, you learn meditation first and your consciousness will tell you, your mind will tell you, the heart will tell you if this is the path you have to follow, if this is the person whom I have to choose as my guru. So it comes with practice. Right now, for example, if you take lessons from YSS, lessons on meditation, YSS, Yoga Sustaining Society, you don't have to take anyone as guru. In our organization, we are not gurus. We are just teachers explaining things as swamis. Our guru is Param Shivanandji. You don't have to accept him as guru. Whether guru has come to you or you have come to guru, let's not worry about this theoretical question. You practice meditation, then your heart tells you, is this the path you want to follow for the rest of your life? Then you can accept him if your mind and heart prompts you that way. Now, one more I would like to tell. This Yoga Sasanga lessons give us information about how to meditate. Basic question, how to sit, spine straight, gaze at Kutastha, things like that, and where to put the hands and mind. Step by step by step, everything explained. All three techniques of meditation. Not only meditation techniques, I mean, all other things that are required for leading a harmonious life, balanced development of body, mind, and soul. Everything is given. For example, how to improve our memory, which is required for all of us. Increasing the power of initiative, dynamic willpower, energizing the body, physical, mental, and spiritual healing of body. How to get along with others. How to choose your vocation. How to get rid of stage fright. Name anything that's required for our daily life. All these things are there. Diet, fasting, how to walk, how to breathe. Everything is explained there in these lessons. Not only meditation, other things are there that are required in daily life for harmonious living, balanced development of body, mind, and soul. They're all given in the lessons. So once you start reading lessons, then you'll understand when Paramahansa Yogananda is your guru or not. Maybe he has drawn you today to this talk, and if you become, fine, that means he found you. And maybe it's your soul searching, and you are looking for something, you have found Guruji. Doesn't matter.
Swamiji, there are a couple of people asking the difference between joy and happiness, and also asking then why are so many people depressed if everyone should be in joy?
That I can understand. See, these words, it's up to you use the word happiness, joy, bliss. Maybe degrees. Bliss is the deeper degree of joy, happiness. These are the words. Positive thing. Peace, I can say, that can be distinguished. Peace means absence of sorrow. Absence of pain. Absence of pain and sorrow is peace. But joy and happiness, something where you are actually joyful, not just absence of peace and suffering, absence of pain and suffering, you are joyful. You are joyful. That's how I distinguish peace and joy.
Yes, Swamiji, Atul is asking, how can we learn to meditate? I think you already mentioned the lessons of YSS.
Yes.
I have one more question.
Lessons one can read. And one more thing, if you look into our website, Yoga Sasanga Society website, there are some basic meditation techniques explained. 15 minutes, meditation and expand our consciousness. Meditation to live fearlessly. Meditation and expanding our love. Like that, various topics are there, short, 10 to 15 minutes. Their guided meditations are there on our website. That way also you can have a glimpse of meditation.
So Swamiji, one set of questions are coming. How did you discover Guruji? Tell us a little bit about your journey.
Pardon?
How did you discover Paramahansa Guruji? Tell us about your journey, Swamiji.
About my journey? Oh, definitely I can tell. Let's put this question at the end.
Okay.
I will definitely answer, but at the end, because other questions we can answer, because this may take a little longer. First, let's exhaust other questions, then I'll come back to, definitely I'll answer the question.
Thank you, Swamiji.
Definitely I'll answer.
Another question is, what is the difference between meditation and visualization?
No, visualization is a simple thing. Like it's using mind, our imagination and creativity. Just imagine, visualize. That also is very helpful. But meditation, I would say, is generally a technique of pranayama, where we control our prana. So it's something to do with breathing sometimes. We do just some special breathing or a particular way. That is meditation. Visualization means just imagination, visualize. So there is a difference.
Swamiji, what
normally, we meditate, calm down, interiorize, go become antarmukhi, then visualize. It's very, very effective and powerful. After meditation, we go to visualization.
Swamiji, what is it that prevents people from living to their full potential?
See, it is, let me tell you one thing. It may have pain and suffering are something thrust on us by circumstances over which we have no control. Don't you agree with that? Pain and suffering are something thrust on us over which we have often have no control. But joy, peace, happiness are something we can manufacture within. You can do it, I can do it. Joy is something we can manufacture within. How? Meditation. Paramahansa Yogananda said that peace cannot be purchased in the market. Peace has to be manufactured within. Initially, I also could not understand what is meant by manufacturing within. That is what is meant by meditation. When you meditate, peace is manufactured within. And that indirectly answers your question. Why they are not living to their full potential means they are not even aware of it. They are not making an effort to bring that potential out. Meditation is the pickaxe to bring that potential that is already within you. I told you initially, if you take care of your body with right diet, right exercise, etc., body gives you health, mobility. If you take care of your mind by positive thinking and intellectual pursuits, it gives you intelligence, ability to get along with others. That's what people are doing. They are becoming intelligent, but they are not nourishing their soul. When you nourish your soul with meditation, soul gives the full potential of creativity. Intuition. Intuition is the highest faculty we have, not just intelligence. Intuition. Creativity. That comes from soul. People are not able to use that potential because they're not cultivating it. They're not bringing it out. Meditation helps. So this should answer your question. Why we are not linked to our full potential, although we have it, they're not taking it out.
Swamiji, another question is that how do we fight evil within us, which stops us from doing good things? The evil.
See, just wishful thinking will not help. I wish I do this. I wish I did that. I wish is not going to help in real life. We have to do. We have to do. Evil is there, yes. Evil is there all around us. If you want to pick, you know that your whole being will tell if you are doing something wrong. There is definitely that reaction is there. But that's where you have to have some self-control. Self-control. And recognize evil and put it out. And if you are regularly meditating, your conscience will not allow you to yield to evil so easily. Meditation helps that one also to become more a more moral person. That helps, definitely. First thing is you have to recognize the evil. You have to recognize temptation and the pitfalls associated with evils and temptations. Next is not to yield. That power comes with meditation, definitely. Willpower. Willpower, we can develop through meditation also.
Swamiji, next question is, how do we take the peace of meditation to activities of the day and how does it help in decision making?
Oh, it's very easy to understand. If I am excited, some emotion is there in me, emotion of anger, emotion of jealousy, or emotion of happiness, or emotion of, you know, flattery, emotion of this, emotion is there in me. I'm not natural. I can't take a good decision. Don't you agree with that? I'm not natural and I'm emotional with any of this. And meditation is the one which also helps you to control your emotions. They will control your emotions. When your emotions are in control, you are in a better position to take better decisions. Because you are not controlled by your likes and dislikes. You are not controlled by your anger. You are not controlled by jealousy. You are not controlled by pride. But these are negative emotions. You are free. When you are free from emotions, that consciousness is very clear. Consciousness. So you are likely to take a better decision.
Swamiji, one person is asking how to develop one-pointedness of mind. Hongso is hard and I find it difficult to concentrate. I keep getting distracted.
Yes, when we start, things are distracted. Nothing is easy in this world. So we have to get it. Banat, banat, banjoy. That's what our Param Param Guru said that. That means strive, strive, striving, striving, one day we behold. Keep at it, keep at it. It is, see, meditation, whether it's hangsa or something else, remember one thing. Thoughts must be bothering you. That's what you are referring to, I'm sure. You are not able to concentrate. Bring back mind again and again. So what you have to do? See, when you are walking out in the street, do you have control on the birds flying over your head? No, they keep flying over your head. But can't you prevent a bird sitting on your head and making a nest? Can't you? You can prevent that. Similarly, when you are meditating, thoughts may come and go. When thoughts come and go, they don't disturb you. Passing thoughts won't disturb you. You can go on with your hangsa technique, any other meditation technique. But if you catch one thought and start brooding over the past or building over the future, then that's no more a thought, it becomes an action. And you are emotionally involved in that action and thrown out of meditation. So this is one clue. When you are meditating, if thoughts are disturbing, doesn't matter if they're passing thoughts. Don't catch one thought and brood over. Then you are safe. Your hangsa will still be all right. Throw. Just use willpower. No, not this thought. Throw it out and another thought is all right. Definitely you will succeed. Succeed. Just do it. Do it. See, your job is to make the effort. Then you will definitely receive. If you are sincere, more importantly, if you are regular, sit for some time. I will answer that question. And I promise that towards the end, I will answer the question. There I will come to that. If you are sincere and regular, definitely you will win the battle against your thoughts.
Swamiji, a younger person is asking, if stillness is God, then what about change? Continuous change is the basis of life. If stillness is there, everything will be dead.
No, stillness means it's stillness of thoughts, where emotions, thoughts, anxieties, these are all absent. It doesn't mean there's no change. There are change, life. Change is the law of life. That's going on. That I agree. Stillness I'm referring to is when I sit down and meditate, the stillness of thoughts, emotions, anxieties, sensations, that is different. Life is change. Doesn't mean that when you are sitting in meditation, thoughts keep on changing, you have to change. Thoughts can be absent. That is all right. That is stillness.
Swamiji, somebody is asking, how can we keep away from negative energy during the pandemic?
Again, how do you remove anything negative? By being positive. By being positive, this your meditations, definitely you are so positive. You are positive, automatically the positive energy is there. You are confident that fear is not there. When there is no fear and anxiety, your immunity is definitely better. And you also have a positive influence on people around you. It doesn't mean that we are reckless. We take all precautions at the same time. all precautions that are required to keep us away from this virus, definitely. But at the same time, we don't even entertain the thought that I may be a victim. No, I will not be a victim. So that is being positive. Meditation definitely helps you.
Swamiji, one person is asking, if I want to be happy all the time, how much meditation should I do so that I can make my work also like meditation and be happy throughout and more mindful?
I don't know. Do you mean that I have to tell you how much means in terms of minutes?
I think so, yes.
Okay, then I will come to that question later.
Okay, Swamiji. Then what is Kriya Yoga, somebody is asking, and how can one learn to do Kriya Yoga?
Kriya Yoga is a pranayama technique. It involves a special breathing. We take special breathing through which we take excess oxygen. This excess oxygen decarbonizes the system. When the carbon in the system body is reduced, the venous blood is reduced. When the impurities are less, heart takes rest accordingly. Because heart is the one which pumps this impure blood into lungs and cleans, it takes rest and blood circulation slows down. When blood circulation slows down, senses come under control because they are subdued and you have better concentration and focus. I mean, this is in gist. It involves some special breathing. It's the psychophysiological technique of pranayama through which we attain deeper states of interiorization, that stillness, degrees of stillness. And there we enjoy our true nature, that is Sachidananda, joy. Probably we had to watch the time. I had to answer that question, Atuls.
Yes, Swamiji, you can take that question. One more quickly I'll say, and then you can take the last one. So one is that how can we be detached during meditation and attached to worldly duties at other times?
No, you have to be attached to meditation when you are meditating. And you have to think about your worldly duties when you are there. It's nothing like you should not be detached to your responsibilities. You should not be detached to your family. They are not mutually exclusive. You can be attached to meditation and you can be attached to your worldly responsibilities. Rather, you can be enjoying your meditation and you can enjoy your worldly responsibilities. I would put it that way. You can enjoy both. They are not mutually exclusive. In fact, you become better proficient in your daily responsibilities also if you are regularly meditating.
Yes, Swamiji. Now I'll request Atul to come back and repeat his question for the benefit of
you. He said about my journey, how I came to Paramahansa Yogananda, etc. Is that Atul?
That is right, Swamiji. If you can tell us you start the journey and would love to. I think the audience wants to hear that.
This question often I face. It's nothing new to me. I just recalling my events in my life. That was way back in 1979, some 41 years back. I asked one person to Swami, please teach me meditation. I'd like to learn meditation. He immediately asked, why do you want meditation? Then I told, I understand that meditation helps to deepen our concentration. I need better concentration in my research work. I was a research scholar at that time at IIT Kharagpur. I want more concentration, so I would like to meditate. See, I did not start meditation for God, not spiritual, not religious. It's only to improve my concentration. I mean, it doesn't mean that I didn't have any idea of God. God is there. God is there. For festivals, you know, God means festival. Festival means God, family reunion, special food, holiday, etc. God is there for festivals. God is there for children before exams. God is there for elderly before going to hospice. That was the role I gave to God. Otherwise, to meditate for God or on God, I was not interested at all. There's no way. Then he said, I want to improve my concentration, so I want to meditate. Then he said, you have to spend 20 minutes in the morning and 20 minutes in the evening. Regularly, just 20-20. This was in 1979. This cricket 20-20 came much later. So 20. Then I told him, 20 minutes I can easily give, no problem. But if he knew that pretty soon I was going to spend longer than 20 minutes in meditation, I would have never started meditation in my life. It was only 20 minutes fine, because I was so busy with my work, research. 20 minutes fine. So then I started, generally I'm focused in life. If I take up something, I give it my full try, you know, full, sincere. So I learned Hansa technique, first technique of meditation. And then started practicing regularly. Morning 20 minutes, evening 20 minutes. Morning, evening, regularly. Then, very soon, by His grace, by personal experience, I was convinced of the existence of inner joy and the possibility of contacting that joy on a regular basis. Meditation, no doubt, I wanted only concentration, but when I was meditating regularly, what I found is there's so much inner joy. I was feeling so joyful. I used to figure out why I'm so joyful. It's not because something happened outside. Not because of something outside. In spite of anything outside, I was joyful inside. Morning and evening. Then that 20 minutes has become 30 minutes, has become 40 minutes on its own. Then I read this book, Autobiography Yogi. Until then, I did not read autobiography. I only read the Yoga Satsanga lessons and Hansa and other things. I just started. When I read this book, then I understood. The joy, unconditional joy, is the nature of God. In meditation, you are going inside, you are touching that divinity within yourself. That always results in joy. With that joy comes fearlessness. That with joy comes efficiency. You know, it's out of gratitude I'm telling, not because of any other special qualities I have, gratitude I'm telling. Then PhD I could finish in 2 years. So much so, I had to wait till the mandatory three years was over to submit it. Of say IIT Senate, they gave permission for me to submit 3 months in advance, 2 years, 9 months. As a special case, they considered. That's on record, 2 years, 9 months. That too, not after MTech, after BTech. I did not study MTech also. B.Tech, then Ph.D. Meditation helped me to focus. And that's how I started meditating, enjoy meditating since 1979. Does that answer you, Atul?
Wonderful journey, Swamiji. Absolutely, absolutely. So there are lots and lots of messages coming. Vivek, you'll be delighted to know that lots of people from outside the country. There's one person from Caribbean who said hello to Swamiji. So what a wonderful session we've had. We so wish we had more time, but there's something that we can't stop, and that's time. Truly, truly appreciate Swamiji. You spoke about so much from your heart, and it was just so blissful, I would say. It's brought happiness to so many of us, so much joy to all of us. Thank you so much. Thank you, Vivek, for being such a wonderful host. And hopefully we can convince you, Swamiji, to be back again on the Yogananda Guru series. Once again, thank you very much. And all of you, Jai Guru, and may God bless you.
God bless you all. God bless you all.
Thank you, Swamiji. Thank you, Swamiji.